Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any update. From GradeUp.
Hello friends, welcome to GradeUp. This is the PYSP section. So in this part, we'll be discussing JEE Mains 2017 solutions of mathematics. So in the first section, we are covering the first 10 questions of this paper. And first of all, the categorization. 3 questions were extremely easy. 4 questions were of moderate level. And 3 questions were hard. So I'll tell you on what basis I am categorizing these tough questions. So either these questions will be tricky or these questions will be lengthy. All right, so that's my categorization of a tough question. All right, so let's start with the first question. First question is from the chapter functions. A function f, which is defined from r to minus half to half, defined as this fx is equal to x upon m1 plus x square. So this is the domain of the function f, and this is the codomain. And the function is defined like this. If you need to research on this function, you will see that f0 for this function is equal to 0. So to find the injective or surjective nature of this function, you need to first find the graph of this function. So f0 is equal to 0, this is known to us. If you differentiate this function by u upon v rule, so differentiation of u upon v is equal to, in the denominator you get v square, v u dash minus u v dash. So if you differentiate this function, you'll get minus x plus 1, x minus 1 upon 1 plus x square whole square. You can try doing this, you will get this answer. So this function, the derivative of this function is becoming 0 at x is equal to plus minus 1. So therefore we are getting maximas and minimas for this function at plus 1 and minus 1. The codomain of this function is minus half to half. From the graph, we can check the range of this function, and then we can compare the range and codomain to find out whether this function is surjective or not. So to get you a revision for this injective and surjective, injective functions are the functions which are 1-1 functions, and surjective means onto function. And a function which is both injective and surjective, we used to call them bijective functions. Alright. So f dash x is equal to 0 at x is equal to plus minus 1. If you try making the graph for this, since the codomain is minus half to half, you can check that at x is equal to 1, if you put the value of x is equal to 1 over here, you get 1 upon 2. So therefore, at x is equal to 1, the graph touches this line, which is y is equal to half. And at x is equal to minus 1, the graph touches this line. So on making this graph, we find out the graph looks like this. Right. This point is 0, 0. This point is 1, half. And this point is minus 1, minus half. All right. Now you can see that on making this line, we can see there are two values of x at which you are getting the same value of y. So therefore, this function is not a 1-1 function. This is a many-1 function. Therefore, injective part is completely wrong. This function is not injective. But the range of this function, the range means the values which we get as answers, which we get as solutions after putting the values of x in this function, lie between minus half to half. So therefore, codomain and range both are equal, which means the function is onto, or we can say that this function is surjective function. So surjective is tick, injective is cross. So surjective but not injective. So this is a medium level question, as you can see. You just needed to make the graph of this function. From the graph, we can study for the 1-1 and onto nature for this function. Next is a question from quadratic equations. A little bit sequences and series is getting used over here. You can see that this quadratic is actually x plus r multiplied by x plus r minus 1, where r is starting from 1 up till n. So I can write this quadratic equation like this. This is equal to 10 times n. All right. First of all, we need to find this quadratic equation. Then the condition is given that this quadratic equation has two consecutive integral solutions. So let's say one of the integral solution is k, the other one is k plus 1, since they are consecutive integral solutions. So therefore, the sum of roots can be calculated, the product of roots can be calculated. We can eliminate k after this, all right? And then you can get the value of n out of there. So if you solve this, you will get summation r starting from 1 to n x square plus 2r minus 1 x plus r square minus r is equal to 10n. All right. On solving this whole equation, you just need to solve this thing, 2r minus 1 summation. All right. So we know that the summation of r is n upon n plus 1 by 2. Summation of r square is also known. Summation of r is again known. All right. On solving this whole equation, you will get something like this: x square plus nx plus n square minus 31 upon 3 is equal to 0. I'm skipping the calculation part because it's a bit lengthy. All right. And you should try doing it yourself. It will be a great practice for sequences in the series chapter. So on solving, we'll get this quadratic equation. And this quadratic equation is said to have two consecutive integral solutions. So if the two consecutive integral solutions are k and k plus 1, the sum of these two roots will be equal to 2k plus 1. And this is equal to minus n, because the sum of roots is minus b upon a. And the product of roots is k times k plus 1, which will be equal to n square minus 31 upon 3. All right. And on eliminating k from here, you will get the value of n is equal to 11. So how to eliminate k from here? You calculate the value of k from here, which is equal to k is equal to minus n plus 1 upon 2. Substitute it over here, you'll get a quadratic equation in n, and you can simply find the value of. So moving on to the third question, it is from the topic complex numbers. So let omega be a complex number such that 2 omega plus 1 is equal to z, where z is equal to square root of minus 3. So first of all, we need to find this omega, what this omega is. So 2 omega plus 1 is given as root 3 iota. All right. So the value of omega is equal to minus 1 plus root 3 iota upon 2, which is nothing but the cube root of unity. So omega is the cube root of unity. We know for the cube root of unity, omega cube is equal to 1, and 1 plus omega square is equal to 0. So this always happens. So here, omega to the power 7 can be written as omega, because this is the cube root of unity. And you can apply the condition R1 is R1 plus R2 plus R3 in this case. So you will get 3, 1, 1, 0 minus omega square minus 1 omega square, 0 omega square and omega. So this condition we get over here. All right. On solving this, we get this determinant as 3 times minus 1 minus omega, and this is equal to 3k, which is nothing but minus 3 times 2 omega plus 1, which is nothing but minus 3 times z, which is equal to 3k. So the value of k over here should be equal to minus z. So the only tricky part over here was to identify omega. All right. So some of the students have taken this omega already as cube root of unity. They were lucky in this case, because on finding out, it came as the cube root of unity itself. Next question is from the topic matrices. It's an extremely easy question. As you can see over here, first of all, you need to find the value of 3a square plus 12a. The matrix A is given to you. So first find a square. This is equal to, or you can find directly the value of 3a square. This is equal to 16 minus 48 minus 36 minus 27 and 39. So once you do a square for this matrix, all right, you need to multiply this matrix by itself, then you will get 16 minus 9 minus 12 and 13, then you multiply it by 3, then you add 12a to it. All right, you just need to multiply all the elements inside here with 12, so you get 24 minus 48 minus 36 and 12, and then you need to add these two, so you get 3a squared plus 12a is equal to, this is equal to 72 minus 84 minus 63 and 51. All right, now you need to find the adjoint of 3a square plus 12a. So adjoint matrix for this matrix. So always remember, in case of A, B, C, D, the adjoint matrix is extremely easy. You need to find the cofactor matrix and take its transpose. That's what we do for adjoint matrices. In this case, it is extremely easy. This is just D, A, and minus C and minus B. So that's what we do. All right. So you need to find the cofactor matrix. How to find the cofactor of A? Remove these. All right. So you get D. You write D over here. How to find the cofactor for this? You remove them. You just get C. All right. So it will be C over here. And in this case, it will be B. So this will be minus B and this will be minus C. Sorry. And this will be A. So that's how we calculate the cofactor matrix. That's very easy. And then after cofactor matrix, you need to take the transpose. Sorry, I got confused over here. So this is the matrix which we are getting over here. And after taking the adjoint, you will get 51, 63, and 84, and 72. So this is the final answer for this question, A part. So always remember this thing, all right? Or you can calculate the adjoint by first calculating the cofactor matrix and then the transpose. Next question. S is a set of distinct values of B for which the system of linear equations has no solution. So this system has no solution. So whenever we're dealing with three linear equations in three variables, the one thing which should come to us should be determinants. We need to use determinants over here. So if this system has no solution, what we can do is the determinant of its coefficient should be equal to 0. So we get 1, 1, 1, 1, A, 1, A, B, 1. All right. So this determinant should be equal to 0. On solving this determinant, you'll see that you're getting minus times 1 minus a whole square is equal to 0. All right, you can simply infer from this equation that the value of a will be equal to 1. So that's one thing which we're getting. So the value of a over here should be equal to 1. If the value of a here is equal to 1, the first equation will stay x plus y plus z is equal to 1. The second equation will also become x plus y plus z equal to 1. And the value of a over here, since it's equal to 1, so it becomes x plus by plus z is equal to 0. Since this system has no solution, these two planes should be parallel. All right. In that case only, we can say that these three lines have no solution. So for that to happen, this value of B should also be equal to 1. In that case, you will get x plus y plus z is equal to 1, and the other equation will be x plus y plus z is equal to 0, these simultaneously can't be true at the same time. So therefore, the value of b, the coefficient of b, y over here should be equal to 1. So the question was, if s is a set of distinct values of b, for which the system of linear equation has no solution, then s is, so the set of values of b just contain one element, which is value of b is equal to 1. So therefore, it's a singleton set. So the answer would be C part. Next question is from the topic permutation combination. So it's a bit lengthy question. All right, let's see what's happening over here. A man X has 7 friends, 4 of them are ladies and 3 are men. His wife also has 7 friends, 3 of them are ladies and 4 are men. Assume that X and Y have no common friends. So the friends of X and friends of Y are separate. There is no common denominator over here. Then the total number of ways in which we can X and Y together can throw a party, inviting 3 ladies and 3 men, so that 3 friends of each of X and Y are in this party. So this language is very complicated. Let's break it down first. First, this is X and Y. So X has a total of 7 friends. Y has a total of 7 friends. All right. 4 of them are women. 3 of them are men. Similarly, Y also have 7 friends. 3 of them are women. 4 of them are men. So there can be some separate cases over here. So case 1 is when X is calling all the ladies and Y is calling all the men. Since they need to invite 3 ladies and 3 men in whole, so they need to invite 6 people, and 3 of them should be from the X side, 3 of them should be of the Y side. So the possibilities can be, he invites 3 women and 0 men, and she invites 0 women and 3 men. Other case can be 2-1, all right, and this can be 1 and 2, since the number of women should also be equal to 3. Other case can be 1-2, and here will be equal to 2-1, and the last case will be 0-3-3-0. All right. So these are the 4 possibilities which can take place. So in the first case, we need to select 3 women out of the 4 women friends of X, which can be done in 4C3 ways, and 0 men out of 3 men, which are X's friend, so which can be done in 3C0 ways, multiplied by 3C0 multiplied by 4C3. Second case will be 4C2 multiplied by 3C1 multiplied by 3C1 multiplied by 4C2. Next case, 4C1 multiplied by 3C2 multiplied by 3C2 multiplied by 4C1. And the last one is 4C0 into 3C3 into 3C3 into 4C0. So if you add all this, your answer will be 485. So I'm leaving the calculation up to you. I've explained the question over here. You have to invite 3 people from X side, 3 people from Y side, keeping in mind that 3 of them should be ladies and 3 of them should be men. So answer is 485 D part. Next question is from the topic binomial theorem. So this is the question dealing with the binomial coefficients. If you separate all the binomial coefficients which have 21 in them, you will get 21C1 plus 21C2 up till 21C10 minus 10C1 plus 10C2 up till 10C10. So this is what you are getting over here. All right. You need to calculate these two sums. So let's look at these two sums individually. For this sum, 10C1 plus 10C2 plus 10C10, you need to remember this thing, that NC0 plus NC1 up till NCN, this is always equal to 2 to the power n. So therefore, this expression will be equal to 2 to the power 10 minus 1, since 10c0 is missing over here. And if you have 2nc0 plus 2nc1 up to, since this is 2n plus 1 form, so it write it as 2n plus 1c0, 2n plus 1c1 up to 2n plus 1cn. This is always equal to 2 raised to the power 2n plus 1 upon 2. Since the sum of first n terms, first these terms and the terms which will come after this, so first n plus 1 terms and the later terms, these two sums are exactly equal. So therefore, these two sums total combine to 2 to the power 2n plus 1, and for individual sum you are divided by 2. So therefore, this sum can be written as 2 to the power 21 minus 1, since this term is missing over here as well, upon 2. So this will be minus 2 upon 2. Since if you add all these, you will get this, or you can write it as, if you don't get confused, I am just cutting this, 2 to the power 21 upon 2 minus 1. This is better. All right. So just remember that. I'll give you another example. If you have 6c0 plus 6c1 plus 6c2, okay, this will be equal to 6c4 plus 6c5 plus 6c6. So these two sums are exactly identical. All right. Similarly, in this case, 20c0 plus 20c1 up to 21c10, this will be exactly identical to 21c20 plus 21c19 up to so on. So this value is equal to this. So the final result will be 2 to the power 20 minus 2 to the power 10. And this 1 and 1 will cancel out. This will be 2 to the power 21 upon 2. So this will be the final answer, C part. So it was also a medium level question. Next, for any three positive real numbers A, B and C, this condition is getting satisfied, then B, C and A are in. So just don't get confused over here. This is in the same line. First option is B, C, A are in AP, then A, B, C, then these and these. So first we need to solve this expression, this lengthy expression. If you see, if you multiply these two, you get 225 A square. Similarly, you will get this term of B square over here, plus 9b square, and similarly a term for c square, which is 25c square. Furthermore, you get minus 75ac minus 45ab minus 15bc. This is equal to 0. All right, this is nothing but half 15a minus 3b whole square plus 3b minus 5c whole square plus 5c minus 15a whole square. How do I get this term? Because this reminds me of x square plus y square plus z square minus xy minus yz minus zx. As you can see over here, if x is 15a, y is 3b and z is 5c, then this condition is automatically getting satisfied. So I can write this further to half x minus y whole square plus y minus z whole square plus z minus x whole square. In that case, if this is equal to 0, then we can say that x is equal to y is equal to z. So all of them should be equal, or 15a is equal to 3b is equal to 5c. So if you check the values of b and a in terms of c over here, you get a is equal to c upon 3 and b is equal to 5c upon 3. All right. And if you add a and b, you get a plus b is equal to 2c. So we can say that a, c and b are in AP. Since A, C and B are in AP, therefore B, C and A are also in AP. So therefore, this is the correct option, BCARNAP. Next question says that let A, B and C be real numbers. Fx is given by this quadratic equation, Ax square plus Bx plus C is such that A plus B plus C is equal to 3. So one relation is given relating to this Fx. Fx plus y is equal to Fx plus Fy plus xy for all x and y belonging to real numbers. Then we need to find summation n starting from 1 to 10 Fn. So first of all, if you put the value of x is equal to 1, you get F1 is equal to A plus B plus C. And this value is equal to 3. This is given to us. If you calculate Fx plus 1, you can see from here this is equal to Fx plus F1 plus x. Right. So the value of F1 over here, we have already calculated, this is equal to 3. So F of x plus 1 is equal to Fx plus x plus 3. All right. So this condition we know. From this condition, we can calculate the value of this function at 2. If you put the value of x is equal to 2 over here, you get 3 plus 1 plus 3, which is 4, 7. Right? You can calculate the value of f of 3, which will be equal to 12. And similarly, you can calculate this value up till 10. This is one way of doing this. All right. The other way is you find the sum of the series. So sum is 3 plus 7 plus 12 up till the 10th term. All right. And this sum can also be written like this. 3 plus 7 plus 12 up till tn. As you can see from here, the difference of these two series is forming a AP. So these terms are not in AP, not in some specific series, but the difference is forming an AP. All right. And if you check the second difference, it will be a constant one. So from here, subtracting, you will get 3 plus 4 plus 5, okay, up till 10 terms. This will be the value of Tn. If you subtract these two, S and S will cancel out. Tn and this will cancel out to give you the 10th term, and this will be minus Tn. So the value of Tn will be equal to this. All right. And you can simply find the sum. If you once find this Tn, the nth term, I'll tell you, this nth term is coming out as n square plus 5n upon 2. The next step will be find summation from n varying from 1 to 10. So it is a mixture question of functions, quadratic equation, and sequences and series. So sequences and series is the most important part which is getting used over here. All right. So finally, when you get the value of Tn over here, which is the first n terms of this series, okay, then you can find the sum of these terms up till 10 times. Or if you can find this 1, 2, 3 up till 10 manually, then you can manually add them. That's no biggie. Next question is from the topic limits. Cot x minus cos x upon pi minus 2x whole cube equals when x is tending to pi by 2. There are two ways of solving this question. First is you put x is equal to pi by 2 plus h. Then you can easily solve this question. All right. Or what you can do is you can simply manipulate the question as it is. So I'm going to use this method over here. If x is equal to pi by 2 plus h, you can rewrite this question as limit h tending to 0 cot pi by 2 plus h. So cot pi by 2 plus h is equal to minus tan h. And this cos pi by 2 plus h will be equal to plus sine h. Upon, in the denominator, you get pi minus 2h cube. So you get 8h cube over here in the denominator. So this is equal to limit h tending to 0. Sine h is common over here. Okay. 1 minus 1 upon cos h. upon 8 h cubed. This is what we are getting over here. Okay, so this will be minus 8 h cubed. Sorry, this is minus 8 h cubed if you cube this. And on further solving this equation, you will get sin h times 1 minus cos h upon cos h 8 into h cube. So I'm dividing this h cube into h square. Sin h upon h, when limit h is tending to 0, this is equal to 1, and 1 minus cos h upon h square, this is equal to half. So you should remember these specific limits, sin h upon h, h tending to 0 as 1, and try remembering this also so that you don't have to solve it every time. So this is equal to half. So final answer to this will be 1 upon 16. So this completes the section 1 of previous year solutions of papers 2017. So stay tuned for more tests and doubt clarification. Thank you.